Well, good evening. It's nice to see so many people turning out this time. 2 years ago, there were not as many people. So welcome, fellow citizens and residents of Oak Brook. And we'd like to explain what's going to happen tonight. I don't know the details. It could be exciting. It could be less so. We're going to ask each candidate to present his platform and explain what he intends to do if he were lucky enough to win the race. The first race we're going to be asking the candidates to speak about is the presidential race. So I'll introduce on my right, John Craig, village president. Thank you. And next to him is Gopal Lalamani, who is a longtime member of the Planning Commission. So, John, let me explain that you'll be allowed to speak for 10 minutes, 5 minutes. We cut you in half. and then after which you will hear questions from the audience. And I also have some questions that were emailed to us in the previous couple of weeks. If the audience is hearing some things that they would like to ask questions about, I encourage them to write down on a card, which a colleague of mine has left at the top. You can write those questions down. I will try to consolidate them into one question because many questions are very similar in nature. The questions are going to be posed to each candidate. It's not as if it's going to be an interrogatory session. It's going to be just an informational discussion. So first, let's have John Craig. 5 minutes, please.
Okay.
Can I say one thing first?
Yes.
I'm the timekeeper, and I will give you the 5 minutes. When you're down to 1 minute to go, I will let you know.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you. I didn't hear that, unfortunately, but maybe it's better I didn't. So when do I?
Right. Go ahead.
Well, I want to take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you for coming out tonight to hear our statements and what we're trying to accomplish. First of all, people have asked, well, why are you running for president? Well, I can honestly and sincerely say that it's because of a love for the village and regard for our village and for the lovely and great neighbors I've had since I've been living here almost 24 years. We have great people, good schools, businesses, parks, and I feel I've accomplished a great deal in moving our village forward in my first term as president. As village president, of course, not everyone will agree with you during any time, especially in election season. I can tell you, Lincoln once said that some of the people will agree with you some of the time, but you'll never get all of the people agreeing with you all of the time. And I understand that. But I am not going to let this campaign on my side be carried away by negative stories or unfounded allegations. I'm running a positive campaign, and I'm proud to serve Oak Brook for the past 12 years, 8 years as a trustee, 4 years as president. And I'm focused on the issues of real importance to the taxpayers and businesses of Oak Brook. Economic stability, business development, and more important than anything else, no local property tax. As you well know, many communities are struggling. This is the worst time in economic history in 75 years. Schaumburg, for example, was 22 million short, and they had to finally come forth with a local levy. Oak Brook is not one of them. We have over $9 million in our reserve. I just read where Elmhurst is hoping to build their reserves to $5 million in 5 years. Since my last election, Oak Brook has prospered and we remain in extremely solid financial position. Last year, 2010, we had 9.1% increase in sales tax over 2009. We have a balanced budget and we have no service cuts. We maintained and increased our reserves and we've established a citizens advisory committee. We've acquired grants and $569,000 for beautification of 22nd Street, The 22nd Street widening was $22 million. We've also gotten some state grants. As I said before, or didn't say, maybe it's the $569,000 was given to us in a grant for beautification of 22nd Street between Spring Road and York. We've negotiated on behalf of our businesses, for example, a traffic signal, a stoplight, for Costco. Costco had threatened to leave, and they did $193 million in business last year. That would have been a terrific hit if we had had Costco leave. And fortunately, they are staying. We are going to have their light installed by the end of our construction period, which is in October. I've tried to save money wherever I can. A good example is a fire truck. We had a fire truck that our fire department said we needed replacing. A new one would have cost $1,250,000. I myself called the E1 company in Ocala, Florida, and I spoke to them and I asked them how much would it cost to rehab this truck. They said we rehabbed 18 of that same model. Okay, I only have 1 minute left and I have a lot more to say, but I'll tell you a very quick story. My wife and I bought a condo many years ago in Acapulco. And you can imagine what's happened in Acapulco, Mexico. But one of the signs I saw there the last time was there was habla bien Acapulco. And that means speak well of Oak Brook. It's our home.
Thank you, John. Appreciate that. Gopal.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. There was a time when someone would say that they lived in Oak Brook, and that usually immediately talks about the image of Oak Brook, the aura of Oak Brook, and in terms of how fine and how classy Oak Brook is. It's a crown jewel in the western suburbs, and as a matter of fact, it's a crown jewel in the Midwest. However, of late, the image of Oak Brook has been tarnished very badly. We are in the newspapers, we are on the radio, we are on television, all for the wrong reasons. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Gopal Lal Malani. I'm running for village president, and I'm running to restore that premier image of Oak Brook that we've all been used to in the past. The premier image that will be backed by the reality of a first-class government run with a clear and focused leadership and with utmost integrity and ethics. Our image has been tarnished by the behavior and the decisions of the village officials that are not in the best interests of the people of Oak Brook. I'd like to thank the Civic Association for inviting me this evening and giving me the opportunity to present my platform for a better Oak Brook. For the past more than 5 years, as you had said, Simon indicated earlier, I've served with distinction and actively participated in the Village Plan Commission, and I've also attended many village board meetings. During this period of time, I've become familiar with the challenges, the opportunities, and the great possibilities that are present for Oak Brook. As you know, there are two candidates that are running for village president, and I'm proud to state today that the Oak Brook Community Caucus, as well as the Daily Herald and the Doings, have all endorsed me for that position. By way of introduction, I'm a practicing cardiologist, I'm a business owner, and I also earned my MBA from Northwestern University, Kellogg Graduate School of Management. My wife of 35 years and I have been in Oak Brook for over 23 years. My wife happens to be sitting in the back right there. Neetu, if you could be kindly recognized. She's done a lot of work for me in this campaign and helped me all the way. I need to indicate to you that I have a strong track record of leadership, sound judgment, and decision making. I've been involved in many organizations, not only at the local county level, but also at the state and the national level. My track record of leadership, reaching out to people, building consensus, and producing results has been there for over 25 years. And this is what I will bring to Oak Brook. I believe Oak Brook deserves better. It's time for leadership in Oak Brook. We need to bring back competency, honesty, trust, teamwork, and the highest morale in Oak Brook. Our morale at this time in the village is at an all-time low. You may have heard that our chief of police has been served with a no confidence motion or a vote from the rank and file police officers. And what does that tell you about the morale? I'm really saddened by the turn of events in Oak Brook for the last several months. Second reason I'm running for this position is that I want to bring back accountability, transparency, ethics, and integrity. As you know, the village president doubles up as a liquor commissioner. I pledge to you, if and when I do get elected as a liquor commissioner, I will never accept any campaign donations or favors or free food or for drinks or so on and so forth from any of the establishments that I regulate. The third reason I like to run for this position is that I like to maintain the high quality services that our residents and the commercial sector have gotten used to. The fourth reason I like to run for this position is that we need to bring about meaningful commercial expansion in Oak Brook. I will be actively participating and involved in expanding the business opportunities, bringing the high-end businesses which will generate sales tax revenue to back to Oak Brook. It's about raising revenues through expansion of our business or commercial center, and it's also about reducing expenses, for example, the high legal bills that we've had in the last couple of years. Finally, I promise to you and I pledge to you that I'll remain engaged, interested and involved in the day-to-day operations of the village, but I will not micromanage. I will build practices and priorities to protect your home values, our families, our health, and our safety. I believe I have the required skill set, I have the leadership track record, and I have the passion to take Oak Brook from where it is now to where it needs to be. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, I need your help. I'm an underdog in this race. I do not have the name recognition that my opponent has. Neither do I have the Chicago-backed campaign machine or the large war chest. Mine is a very small grassroots campaign. All I have is you. And I'm counting on your support and a strong support for the campaign on April the 5th. Thank you for your attention. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Gopal. We appreciate that. Is there anybody in the audience who has any questions that they would like to give to me? One, two coming up. Now, the trustees' candidates are in the lucky position of being pre-warned about these questions that come up because they're very similar to you. Unfortunately, Gopal and John are not in that fortunate position. They'd be having questions thrown at them unprepared. Where are the questions? Well, while we're waiting for that, here's the first question. There are two trustees, or three trustees, I think, who are not soliciting funds for their campaigns, and it is felt by some that an enormous amount of money is spent on campaigns by candidates. It's greatly increased in the last decade or so. Is it appropriate to spend so much? John?
Well, I can only tell you that personally, I wouldn't know how much is in my campaign fund at this moment. I refer to my wife to handle all that sort of thing. But I can tell you, unless you get out, ring doorbells, go door to door, put up signs, and print literature, you're not going to have a successful campaign.
Okay. Gopal.
Yeah, well, I don't have, as I indicated, the large war chest that my opponent has, but you do need a bare minimum to reach out to people, talk to people, knock at their doors, send mailings out. And as you know, my name is not a household name in Oak Brook, even though I've lived for 23 years. So I do have to overcome that obstacle to reach out to people, so get to know me and what the platform is and what is it all about. And whatever we need to spend, it's a bare minimum that my grassroots campaign is spending. But I don't get the $10,000 contributions, for example, that my opponent is easily able to get from the establishments that he regulates. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Next question that was, I've consolidated a lot of these questions that came to us via email. So the next question is regarding closed sessions and open sessions of the village board. Apparently, there are almost as many closed sessions as there are open sessions. And how do you feel about this, and what would you do to reduce the proportion of closed sessions and have a greater proportion of open meetings? John.
One of the things that you must recognize is lawsuits. When I started as village president 4 years ago, we had about 14 lawsuits. One lawsuit with the DuPage Housing Authority for the Friary amounted, if they had won, $13.8 million. That would have wiped out our reserves. Now, you can't discuss lawsuits, at least I'm told this by attorneys, in an open session, because then you have given away your position, and we can't do that. Now, we've eliminated lawsuits round the clock. We've kept on this. We've gotten rid of some very, very costly suits. And one, as I said before, I was the only sitting village board member to testify in the federal court against the Friary. And I want to tell you, we were found not guilty on all four counts. So that went a long way to saving $13.8 million. But we do have sessions where we have to have a closed session. And anybody in law will tell you that if you have an open session, and then there are personnel items where we don't reveal the name of the person that we're discussing and the problem they're having.
How would you vote in future on closed meetings, John, whether to close the meeting or not?
I would observe just what I told you now, that lawsuits are something we don't discuss. If it's something that we can discuss, we're making our, we have on our website right now, we've added all the contracts we have. If you want to see what we're doing in business, look it up on our website. It's posted.
Thank you, John. Gopal, what would your attitude be towards these?
Well, I've been watching the board meetings for the last couple of years, and it sounds like there are more closed meetings than open meetings. Even your the ad hoc or advisory committee on Citizens Finance Committee, for example, I was appalled at one of the meetings that it was voted that the minutes or the contents of the meeting not be posted on the website to close it or semi-close it. Why? What are we hiding? These should be open public forums. I think we have a mumbo-jumbo situation here. At the last board meeting, for example, there was a fire and police commissioner talking about personnel issues, mentioning the names of people who are involved in the police that were affected by some of the adverse decisions that were made. That should have been in a closed meeting. And I think the chair of that meeting, or whoever is chairing that session, should have shut him out and said that these are personnel issues that should be in a closed meeting. I'm sort of confused about what's going on here. Okay. There are issues that should be in a closed meeting that are being discussed and not being stopped by the chair, and there are too many closed meetings that we don't even know what they are about. I do understand there are some meetings that have to be in a closed session. There are personnel issues, legal issues, and such sort of things.
Thank you, Gopal.
We need to be a little clear about what we are doing, and I think that's where the confusion is here.
Thank you. Next one is about video recording of village meetings. We are being recorded tonight, so that if you think you have missed something, you could always go to the village website and see the same meeting that you're enjoying tonight. What is your position, John, on broadcasting of all village boards meetings as opposed to just audio recordings?
We do use videotape at every official board meeting. We don't use audio tapes. We have a visual cameraman, and it's quite costly, but that's something that we provided for the public.
Okay. And what is your position on video recording of all meetings?
I think that's a great idea, because not everybody can attend the meetings, and they should be able to have the opportunity to see how a village is being conducted and how dysfunctional it can be at times.
Good. Now, voters elect representatives, and the board has appointed unelected Citizens Financial Advisory Committee. The CFAC recommended a 1% food tax in order to raise revenues pretty substantially for the village. What is your position? Let's start with Gopal this time, so a bit fairer. Is your position, Gopal, on unelected advisory boards and on their recommendations?
First of all, I happened to be there at the meeting where there was a discussion about introducing a 1% tax on restaurant about a year ago. I can tell you one thing, under my administration, there will be no new taxation. Those type of recommendations will not be entertained. There will be no increase in taxes and there will be no new taxation. We need to reduce expenses rather than increase taxation. I think we are being taxed enough by the state and otherwise. Secondly, in terms of having these committees, advisory committee, I believe that, as a matter of fact, we have 3 or 4 MBAs on the village board, and they should be competent to handle. I happen to be an MBA as well, as you may have seen in my resume. I think we should be able to handle the competently and by working together with the members of the board and handle all finance issues or whatever difficulties we have, whatever budgeting we need to make sure that we balance revenues with expenses, not the Band-Aid approach that we've been following for the last couple of years, but a real strategic plan so that we can visualize what we are doing and bring about a balance in our budget. By the way, we've had a balanced budget for over 20 years that I've lived in Oak Brook, so balancing the budget is nothing new under this administration. But I will not have advisory committees or ad hoc committees unless there is a specific issue or a difficult issue for which I may need advice from time to time, and I'll be happy to go to whoever I need to go to who has an expertise that is better than what we have on our village board. But okay. I will not have any advisory committees that are standing committees reporting to the board. I think the board should take responsibility for all those okay. actions.
Thank you, Goebel. Thank you. John.
Well, I want to say this, that our financial advisory committee has as its chairman a CPA that is heading one of the Forbes 500 corporations, if I'm not mistaken. And he has some excellent ideas. They've given us some good guidance. And I always feel there's an old saying, two heads are better than one. If I can get another opinion, you can tell me a way we can save money and help our village, please step forward. And I mean that sincerely. And while we're on that, whoever becomes president will find the same block that I had, just trying to find people that are willing to step forward and serve on a committee. People don't want to do that.
Okay, thank you. The next question might be a little difficult. The legal costs in the village have been some $2.4 million over the last 4 years. And at the current rate of expenditure on legal services, it will run at about $700,000 a year. Most of these payments have been made to a company called Odelson Stirk, and that's a company that was not previously employed as for legal advice by the village of Oak Brook. How do you propose, John, to reduce these costs?
Well, first of all, these costs were increased because we had so many union cases, and we were being charged by Seyforth and Shaw, a very, very fine legal community, but they were charging us $385 an hour. Now, Mr. Stirk's cost is $186 an hour. Now you say, oh, we have 2 million or a million or something. You have to remember that wasn't all paid to that law firm. That was paid the biggest portion, the highest legal bill we've had in my 4 years didn't come from Stirk, Odelson Stirk. It came from Seyforth and Shaw, who we brought in on cases that were specialized with unions. And one of the unions was a placebo case that if we had lost that, and it cost us a great deal of money to win it, but instead of paying $384,000 or $354,000, we'd have been paying better than $1 million a year for good for all the union employees for their hospitalization and placebo claims. That's if you're hurt in some kind of a way, supposedly on the job,
okay.
or allegedly.
Thank you, John. Goebel, legal costs, what would you do about them?
That's a Pandora's box. I mean, the legal bills is just astronomical. For a village of less than 8,000 by the current census that we have, a small family of, I think it's 7,800 to be exact, the legal bills of $2.3 million or more over the last 4 years, by any standards, by any calculations, is excessive. I find it hard to believe in spite of the number of legal actions that have actually gone down in Oak Brook significantly, we still have this legal belt. In January this year, forget about a couple of years ago when we had union and other issues. In January, the bill was about $60,000. In February, it was another $60,000. That's excessive by any measure. So I think the first thing that I will do is reduce the legal bills by half. Hopefully, by reducing legal bills, maybe we can provide more services to our community. That's number one. Number two, I think there is a clear conflict of interest with our current village attorney that we have. He comes from the same company that serviced Todd Stroger. You can read in between the lines. He also is a major contributor to my opponent's campaign. Isn't that a conflict of interest? And there are hidden agendas that we can see here? I think I have a major issue and reservation about this situation at this time. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The next one concerns liquor. State law apparently requires the villages and towns to appoint their president or mayor as the liquor commissioner. State law apparently only requires one commissioner. And perhaps it's onerous for the single commissioner to personally visit premises in following his duties. So what thoughts, if any, do you have on spreading the responsibility to perhaps a trio of commissioners as the police and fire commissioners is shared by several?
Well, first, before we could do that, we'd have to get the state legislature to change the law. We can't, as the law is set up now, the suburb or village, little town, has a liquor commissioner and a chief investigator. My chief investigator happens to be the police chief. Now, I rely on him to tell me if there's a violation. But when somebody calls me, I don't avoid telephone calls. Anybody here has called me, I return my call right away, even if I know it's going to be an adversity. I call it, and I've listened to many people call me about different things, some positive, some negative. And as I said before, as long as I'm president, we're going to take the high road, and we're going to follow the law. And we have. We find. The very civic association here, when I find an individual liquor establishment, I gave them the greatest percentage of the village fee for that fine to the civic association. And only one member, besides my wife, told me, thank you. And that was Nellie Naguib. Not one of them did I hear from that paid for the civic association carnival. But that's all right. I'm not looking for a thank you, but I'm telling you that when there are situations that call for my attention, and I was a policeman, I was on the highway police, and I was on investigations on liquor establishments, I'm going to follow through and find out what's happening and what's going on at that time. And if I can help your civic association, I do it again.
Well, John, I apologize. I did not know you had donated money to the Civic Association. I did not know that.
Paid for the entire winter carnival.
Okay.
Any one of them can say, oh, no, I never gave that money.
Perhaps it was the time when I was in hospital for several weeks and months.
Oh, okay.
So I apologize.
Sorry. My wife could testify to it.
Okay. Now, Gopal, back to the main question of sharing responsibility in these commissions. The Liquor Commission being the subject of this question. How would you feel about that?
This is another issue that I have a problem with, the doubling up of village president as a liquor commissioner, but by state code, we do need to perform that function, and I'd be happy to do that. But I can promise you one thing. I promise to you that I'll perform that function with ethics and integrity and transparency. There will be no underhanded dealings. There will be no situations that will be of suspicion. The first thing I'll do once I'm elected president is I will return those documents that have gone to the police department. They were confiscated from our village clerk where they belong. One fine day, they were taken away from the village clerk and went to the police department. We have a morale issue with the police department. I'm not even sure if the chief of police should be involved in this type of commissioning of our liquor, because there are issues there, which I won't get into. Secondly, if I do have to serve as a village commissioner, I will set an example under an ethics ordinance. And we need to lead by example. And that type of example has to come from the top. I certainly will not accept donations from them. I will not accept free food and drinks and all the other nonsense that we referred to earlier. That will end under my administration. Okay. The final thing I like to mention is I will not go into the details of the Sky Bar brawl that those people have heard about, but I do believe that outfits like the Sky Bar do not belong to the fabric and the premier community of Oak Brook. I think there are situations there, there are irregularities in their licensing, there are irregularities in the conduct of their business. There are things that I can't tell you, but if you go to the website, you'll know what I'm talking about. Outfits like Sky Bar will have to go under these circumstances, unless they change the format of the Sky Bar. I think as a liquor commissioner, I make sure that that type of thing will not happen in Oak Brook.
Returning to the sharing of responsibility, yeah. To sum it up, John, are you in favor of expanding the commission members?
It isn't something that I can be in favor of or against. If you can get the law change, if we can get that change in Springfield, fine.
My understanding is that there's no restriction on increasing the membership of such commissions, only that the village president has to...
Oh, I believe there is. I think my village attorney is wrong, and I'll have to question him again. I'm not an attorney in that
okay.
respect. But I can tell you this, that people that say things about establishments, and I've tried to say this before, just remember, we all live here, and we want to give Oak Brook a good name. Believe me, when I represent Oak Brook, I do it in a professional way. And anybody in business here in Oak Brook can tell you that anytime I've had contact with them, I've never had one person say that I use profanity or they ever, ever mistreated them. And I intend to continue that as long as I'm president of this village.
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple of questions here that disturb me a bit. The purpose of this meeting is to allow these good gentlemen to present their platforms and to present themselves and explain why they would be the best candidate for the job. So with tongue in cheek, I'm going to read this one. And it is sincerely tongue-in-cheek, and I'll give you the same question to both. Are you a member of the Muslim Brothers, John?
The what?
Are you a member of the Muslim Brothers?
The Muslim Brothers?
That's the question. You don't have to answer it.
Well, I'm quite candid with you. I don't know who they are.
Okay. So, moving on. I won't ask you, Gopal, because I don't think people really care. Okay.
First of all, I don't know this organization, okay. But I do have to tell you that I was raised in the Hindu faith,
okay.
and I believe in universality of religions. I believe in caring and compassion and treating people with dignity and respect. So, but whatever this organization is, if you could provide me details, I'd be interested in listening to you.
I'm trying to do my job and passing on the questions, some of which I just don't want to get into. Again, it's not an interrogatory occasion here. It's just listening to these good men and their platforms.
I think it's nice to be interrupted by some comic interruptions.
Okay, now here you're approaching the end here. If elected, will you refuse donations to your campaign fund from companies or individuals associated with such companies with whom the village does business, or Oak Brook businesses which depend upon village licenses or are regulated by Oak Brook? Would you refuse donations?
I certainly would. And first of all, we don't have any village licenses in the village of Oak Brook. And you can look at my contributions. I have not taken a dime from any institution that sells or dispenses liquor. And when I did receive something, I returned it exactly as the way the State Board of Elections determined that we do so. But I don't have anything. I'm going to ask my campaign manager, do we have any contributions? Not a contribution from a business in Oak Brook.
Gopal, the question is not just businesses, but people associated with those businesses.
Well, I think I've made my position extremely clear. I will not take any contributions or favors or anything else from the businesses that we do with in Oak Brook, or the establishments or the restaurants or the bars or the legal firms. My opponent has received a major contribution from the legal firm that works with the village every day. That's a clear conflict of interest. I mean, that's an unequivocal conflict of interest. So, but I will not do any such things. I have no agenda here. My only agenda is the advancement of Oak Brook. I have no hidden agendas. I have nothing to do. What I'm going to do is what is best for the people of Oak Brook.
Thank you, Gopal. Last two questions. Trustees, candidates, pay attention to this one. Would you support, you're lucky, you're pre-warned. Would you support having video recorded debates between candidates in 2 years' time?
In 2 years' time, I don't care if you have Mickey Mouse and Donald. Last hurrah for me. I would never run for this office again or any other office.
Then the second question doesn't really apply, but if you are running for re-election in 4 years, would you participate in such a debate?
I guess you didn't catch Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse.
I was just reading
the question. Not running for anything ever again. Okay. I'm 76 years old. I'm ready to go.
You look young enough.
Pardon?
You look young enough.
Thank you. I'll leave it go at that.
Well, this is another interesting thing. As a matter of fact, my opponent said 4 years ago that he will not run again. So I thought I'm going to get a free pass this time, but here he is sitting next to me and debating me away. So I don't know what to trust or what not to trust about what you said. You said 4 years ago unequivocally this is your only term. I can promise you one thing. You asked us the question about videotaping the debates, right?
Yes. Well, a debate in the first instance, which would be videotaped.
Yeah, right. I would be in favor of that right now. Okay. I won't even wait 4 years.
Okay, thank you. Well, that concludes, ladies and gentlemen, the positions and statements of the two candidates running for village president. Does anybody else have any other questions of these good people? Okay, we will move on to the trustees. The names of the trustees are in front of them, so you should be able to determine who's who if you don't recognize them already. So you've been forewarned of these pretty similar questions, but I've got another couple of interesting ones. We might as well start with those.
Before our speeches?
Sorry?
Don't we get to introduce ourselves?
Do we get to...
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Five minutes.
I forgot. Why don't we start with Michael Manzo, far end.
Thank you. My name is Michael Manzo. I'm running for village trustee. Nearly 10 years ago, my family and I moved to Oak Brook. The reason we moved to Oak Brook was simply it was a great place to live and a great place to raise a family. That's extremely important to me. Individuals will ask me why I'm running, and the main reason is to keep Oak Brook a great place to live, work, and raise a family. My daughter Michelle, 14, my son Rocco, 13, my little one Melissa, 9, they love it here in Oak Brook. We're going to raise our family in Oak Brook. Several years ago, my father-in-law passed away. My mother-in-law, Elda, moved in with us. She loves Oak Brook. So that is the purpose of me running for trustee. Before I get into the village issues, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. My family and I are very involved in our community. I am an Oak Brook Little League coach. I was an Oak Brook Community Caucus member. My wife is a CCD teacher and a precinct captain. She's also involved with the schools as I am. And I decided that it was time, because I see Oak Brook at a crossroads, that it's time for me to step up my involvement in Oak Brook and run for trustee. My education includes a bachelor's degree in finance from SIU, an MBA from Dominican University. My experience before I moved to Oak Brook, I served on a school board for 7 years. involved in a budget that was well over $40 million, involved with negotiations, involved with employee issues. I've spent the last 8 years as Chief of Staff to County Commissioner Tony Pareca. You may have heard of him. We fought the corruption from Cook County. We fought Todd Stroger, and we created a more transparent government. Some of the issues that I'd like to speak of, that issues that are facing Oak Brook today, are number one, government waste. As been mentioned before, attorney fees are astronomical. There was discussion, I know we'll be discussing them later, but $2.4 million over the last 4 years is much too much for a village our size to be paying, especially since the number of lawsuits have actually gone down, or as President Craig said, has been eliminated. But yet we are still on track this year to spend well over $700,000 on attorney fees. Employee overtime, we have spent between $700,000 and $1.1 million per year over the last 4 years on employee overtime. And another concern, expenditures for the village. Our expenditures did not go down this year. The 2011 budget shows an 8% increase in spending, or I think approximately $4 million in additional spending from the 2010 budget. We need to keep our expenditures in line so we don't have to go to a property tax, so we don't have to go to an additional sales tax or food tax. And the way to do that is keeping expenditures in line. Another issue, as you probably have heard of, is the low employee morale we have in Oak Brook, probably the lowest we've ever had. Everything from a no confidence vote with the police chief, where I believe 25 out of 30, something like that, police officers voted no confidence on the police chief, to a negotiations with our fire department, which has caused a tremendous hardship on our village. The problem we're having with those negotiations is we're negotiating in public. One should never negotiate contracts with employee groups in public. That needs to be done behind closed doors. We don't need individuals at board meetings referring to our employees as street people. That helps nobody, and it certainly doesn't help Oak Brook. The other issue that I did want to speak of, I have 1 minute, is the lack of transparency. There are meetings where the closed session is longer than the public session. It gives the appearance of impropriety. Everybody understands that personnel matters, litigation has to be in closed session. But I don't think there ever should be a reason that we should be sitting 2, 3, 4 hours in closed session when we're only in the public session for 1 hour. Those are the issues that I feel are important to Oak Brook. Those are the issues I'm going to address if elected. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Michael. Keishin.
Thank you very much for having me here. Why I decided to run, I don't know. Having said that, I lived in this country 37 years. I lived the longest time in my life in this town, 27 years. I think I'm the longest guy who lived here. All my children grew up here, went to the Butler School and the Hinsdale Central. And now they are doing their own jobs, and I have 9 grandchildren from them. All, unfortunately, all sons, not boys. So whenever we get together, I always invite animal trainer. I was told, I was asked, Alice, one of my good friend, and who is very active in the village, don't you want to return something to the community who's been kinder to you? And I, all my life in the United States, I spent doing my life in the medical practice. I served as president of medical staff of Good Samaritan Hospital with 900 physicians. I was only one Korean guy who was elected. And I'm right now serving as a governing council members of a Good Samaritan Advocate. All idea is I want to do, make the human society better. I spent my life, I was born in North Korea, came down during the Korean War. As of the 2,000 miles, I walked down. And I don't think any of you had ever experienced of starving. My mom has been going around knocking the door, asking the food to feed us. That was my life. I came down south, I went to school, And I fought entire my life against the dictatorship. To me, it's right and wrong is important. Our first president, President Lee, who was in spite of a Princeton grad, he was a dictator. My high school, February 28, 1959, I was a first grade, we took to the street. That is the beginning of new career. It's known as a Student Revolution Day. And the April 19th, president resigned. After that, just a year later, when I was a second, the junior, the 11th grade, there was a military coup by President Park. I, from all my college life, medical school, I spent the times in anti-dictatorships, in spite of my father was one of the ruling party members. I was arrested, I had a 200 strike, so nothing can threaten me. And so it's a, that was the idea is we want to make, it's not me, it's a for all. And since I joined, I thought this town was a great town. I never heard about anything bad things about Oak Brook. Whenever I got out, even until December, I live in Oak Brook. Oh, that's a great city. But I didn't know all the reputation. But I'm not so sure right now. I'm not so sure which side I have to side with. Two factions divide in this kind of town. Almost a visceral hatred each other. If somebody read Doing's newspaper, all those of the letters, comment attached to it, I hope you should be ashamed. Each other going out, personal attack, and everything innuendos. In medicine, we have a saying, I hope your doctors will do the same practice, evidence-based medicine. It's everything should be based on evidence, not emotions. Somebody said something, innuendos, emotional upbringings. I had a couple of things is said, all those accusations came. I looked at some of evidence-based, some seems to be totally wild. If this town is so corrupt, how everybody is saying we have wonderful police service? How we have so much good fire station and the good service? Everybody says we have a great police, great fire. And the budget is under control. I don't know what is right, what is wrong. I think this is time. We are all grown ups. I am 66 almost. And I don't know, at the time retirement, I want to give us something. The teacher of my children here, I'm grateful to that teacher sitting here. And always the same, I'm grateful to the education provided from this city. And not to be selfish. Let's be grown up. Let's try. Is this a personal attack, personal agenda? Do I have any anger because something happened a few years ago? Let's grow up out of it. So if I would like to be, if I am fortunate enough, I will be in there. I'm the guy who is not endorsed, by the way, by the caucus, by the newspaper, neither one endorsed. It couldn't be political enough. But if I am there, at least I would like to balance out between two disaffectionate teams. So that's my hope. I can be something, you know, I think the name of Oak, as I heard, is indicating rectitude, fortitude. This is time of Lent, time of the Easter holiday. Let's learn how to forgive. Let's learn to be not to be tempted. So this is my...
Thank you. There was no preconceived idea of which order these signs would be put in, so... Asif, take the next one.
Sure, looks like it's running along the pattern.
It was by accident that these
Dave, I hope your batteries go out on that timer. Good evening, everybody. My name is Asif Yusuf. I've lived in Oak Brook for 29 out of the last 33 years. I was born in Chicago. My folks moved to DuPage County in 1966. They moved to Oak Brook in 1979. I lived in Westmont, about 100 feet outside the village boundaries from late 1988 to early 1992, moved back into town. I currently live in Brook Forest on Hamilton Lane, which is behind the school. My wife, Azra, and I are raising four children. We have a junior in college at DePaul, sophomore and junior at Hinsdale Central, and a sixth grader. My wife is not here because she's helping my sixth grader with his homework tonight. We're coming up to our 23rd anniversary. A week from Sunday. I gotta buy her something. And I've enjoyed living here. I'm running because I see room for improvement. I see room for positive change. I care about the village. It all boils down to quality of life, whether it's the quality of services we enjoy, the low financial burden on us, the value of our homes. It's all a package that comes together, and we need to maximize that. And it's not a question of are things good or are they bad, it's a question of are they the best they can be? Can we do some things differently with better results? I think the answer is yes. I think I can be part of the improvements, and that's why I'm running. I served on this board from 2003 to 2007. I understand the role of a village trustee. I understand something about municipal law. I'm not an attorney, but you certainly gain something from experience. I have a financial background. Family business is commercial real estate, mostly office and industrial space. Nothing located in Oak Brook. The only thing I own in Oak Brook is the home I live in. I have a real estate broker's license. I don't actively practice in town. I have an insurance producer's license. I previously held a real estate appraisal license, which I wasn't using enough to justify keeping it. I understand the real estate market. I understand the challenges out there. I also own and am involved in a farming operation. We operate about 2,800 acres in central Illinois, primarily in Lee and Ogle counties, which is about an hour and a half west of here. So under normal conditions, I'd say I make my living in dirt, but somebody could take that and put a spin on it, and you'll see it in an anonymous mailing before you know it. But I do watch the price of corn and soybeans instead of the stock market anymore. I'm seeking to be a public servant, not a politician. If you elect me, I'll work for you. I've got a flyer up there. It's got my home number, my cell phone number, which hasn't changed for 10 years, and my email address. If you bring me a concern, you'll get an honest answer. I may agree with you, I may not, but I'll explain myself, and I'll be consistent in my response to everyone. We do need to improve the village's reputation. The reputation's tarnished. It affects our home values. It affects companies deciding to move here or not move here. We need to project stability. And the controversy recently in the papers and all the stuff doesn't do anything to help that situation. I've run before. I've told you at the time the economy's deteriorating, cuts are needed. People criticized me for it. The economy deteriorated, cuts were needed, and they were made because they had to be made. Things are on an uptick. Hopefully they'll stay that way. We're going to have some bumps in the road with the 22nd Street construction. The long-term results will be worth it. When I serve on the board, if I'm elected, I'm going to have a very simple litmus test. Is this good for the people of Oak Brook, for my friends and neighbors, all 7,900 of us? If the answer is yes, I'm going to be for it. If the answer is no, I'll oppose it. I'll speak out against it. I will try and convince those that support it. But I'll also tell them before I do that, try and convince me. I'll give you all the time you need. Tell me why you think this is good. And if you can convince me, I'll support it. I only have a minute left, so I hope you ask a lot of questions. We need to restore checks and balances. I don't believe the move of the liquor license responsibilities to the police department was in compliance with the village code. I don't believe if it was pursuant to legal advice that advice was sound. If it was going to be done, the code should have been amended to allow for it. You can't arbitrarily decide to change things. We do have a morale problem, and we have to get things back on track. If you think I can do the job and do it competently, please vote for me. And if you don't, then my wife's got a ton of projects for me to do around the house. Thank you.
Thank you, Asif. Tony.
Mr. President, Civic Association board members, Mr. Moderator, fellow Oak Brook citizens and guests, and my colleagues here on the board, good evening. My name is Tony DeCanio. I'm a 25 and a half year resident of Fullersburg on Madison Street with my wife, Michelle, graduate of Loyola University with a BS in biology and a graduate of Worsham College of Mortuary Science. I'm a licensed and practicing funeral director. And for the last 34 years and continuing, I'm an instructor at Worsham College. I am a proud member of Fullersburg Woods Area Association since 2006 and currently serve as a president of its organization. I'm also a very proud but humble member of Hinsdale Post 250 American Legion, where I've been elected to the board. I am, of course, a candidate for trustee. You've heard lots of things on the board. There's much redundancy. Many of us feel recognize some of the issues. I recognize that some things may perhaps not be issues. I think what's most important is, what are we going to do with the issues? How are we going to address the issues? First thing, one thing that I think is very important, no changes in our tax structure, specifically no village real estate taxes. This board that is sitting currently has done a wonderful job, got a 6-month reserve. I want a year reserve. The next 4 years of our board, our objective, our goal should be 1 year reserve. And so to do that, we have to be very, very careful in the decisions that we make. Issues. Local representative government is the most perfect form of democracy that we can ever expect. This is almost a one-to-one personal type of government where people can come to a trustee, either through homeowners association presidents or directly, bring an issue. That issue then is presented to the board and discussed. I recommend to the board that we set up regular meetings with the homeowners association presidents at least every 6 weeks, perhaps every month. We can discuss the issues that are relevant to the citizens. I recommend that we set up regular meetings with the major business leaders in our community so that we can hear what they want and we could tell them what we think and believe. And I think that should happen on a regular basis in addition to the chamber and what they do. Furthermore, I am recommending that we establish a trustee on-call program. In the evenings and during the weekends, one of us should be available so that any citizen can reach us and bring to us an issue. When you bring me an issue, it becomes my issue. Your problem becomes my problem, and I promise you that I will solve that. All of the things that we're hearing are campaign things. They've just flared up in the last 4 or 6 weeks. There may or may not be some merit to those things. That's the responsibility of the board to determine if there is merit. How do we do that? A rather simple principle. We listen, we learn, we evaluate, and then we decide. That's what we're here for. We are you. Picture yourself sitting here because we are you sitting here. I'm not only a candidate. I happen to be a resident and a voter. So I'm listening to everything that these gentlemen are saying because I have to choose amongst and between them. When we decide, the simple question, is this going to make Oak Brook a better place? If the answer is yes, we pursue that. There's a Latin phrase. I had to take Latin for 4 years in high school, and I hated it, and you're going to understand why when I try to say this, but the phrase is semper de muneris est, and that translates simply to, it's always about money. This village, we have a wonderful source of revenue from our sales tax, but you know what? The state controls that. If they wake up one morning and say, we're not going to give Oak Brook as much money as we did, we don't get it. We have no control over that revenue. So everything we do, we have to predicate on the fact that we've got to be very careful about how we spend our money. And if we spend a dollar, we got to get a dollar's worth. The issue of morale in the village. You know, I've worked for people. You've worked for people. I bet you woke up one morning and went to work and said, I don't like my boss. Okay? Is that worth hiring thousands and thousands of dollars worth of investigators to determine after 6 or 8 weeks in a beautiful 200-page spiral-bound report? We got some happy policemen and some unhappy policemen. If we fire the police chief, he's going to get paid because he's got a contract. We'll bring in a new police chief. 6 months, we'll have some unhappy policemen and some happy policemen. It's your job. We need to show the village employees we care for them. I want to establish an Employee of the Month and Employee of the Year program. I want to establish a pizza day every now and then. We'll buy you lunch. Thanks for doing the work that you do. We appreciate it. We need you to be part of our village family. Common sense is what we need to dictate everything we do on this board. Common sense with the willingness to understand what you citizens want and then make sure that you get it. I'm going to say one other thing. I'm going to make a prediction here. Charlotte Bruce is going to win the election.
Well, thank you. Any wages?
I'll take all you got.
Okay, thank you. Jerry.
Okay, thanks, Simon. My name is Jerry Wolin. I'm currently a trustee. I'm running for re-election. My wife, Carol, and I have lived in Oak Brook for 10 years. Carol's in the last row in the white jacket. I know she is youthful looking. Let me assure you, she is not a trophy wife. We have been happily married for 48 years. And press, please don't report that. From a career standpoint, I worked for IBM for 27 years in sales and sales management. I then worked for Waste Management for several years in management and also did some consulting. I have an engineering degree from the University of Illinois and an MBA from Harvard University. At this time, I'm retired. I have the time to do the job the way it needs to be done, and I look forward to continuing to do it. I have been very active in local government for over 20 years now. I have served for the past 4 years as a trustee in Oak Brook. Prior to that, I was on the Plan Commission for 3 years. And when we lived in Elmhurst, I served as an alderman on the city council there for 8 years. In addition to being active in village government, I am also active on two DuPage County committees where I meet with mayors and village managers on a regular basis to discuss issues of common interest. After all these years as an elected official, there is no aspect of village government that I am not familiar with, if not knowledgeable about. You want to talk water and sewer pipes, you want to talk library, you want to talk finance, you want to talk police and fire. I've had experience in all those areas. During the 4 years I served as a trustee, significant time was spent balancing the budget during a very challenging economic period. This required a very close control of all of our expenses and a lot of hard work on the part of the board and our staff. As a result of the actions of the village board and the staff, we do have a balanced budget, we do have good reserves, and we're in pretty good financial shape at this point in time. Weathering the financial storm required very close cooperation between the village board and the village staff. Good things don't happen unless you have that. I consider myself a good team player, a very good team player, and I'm very proud of that. Although substantial cuts were made in our budget, we never lost sight of the fact that maintaining high levels of service in all areas was important. And I do believe that for the most part, you have not seen any major cutbacks in any of the service you received. Progress was made in other areas. The bottleneck on 22nd Street under the I-88 bridge was eliminated. The road was widened. 22nd Street is now being rebuilt and widened west of 83, including the stoplight that was mentioned at Costco, a much needed stoplight. In addition, significant progress has been made in bringing new businesses to the area. The village board works closely with the Chamber of Commerce. We have a great Chamber of Commerce, and I'm very proud to have been an active part of the effort to bring businesses to this community. Going forward, in the short term, I do believe we need to resolve the issues that have surfaced in the police department, the no confidence vote that was talked about. There are other issues. From my perspective, the only way we are going to resolve those satisfactorily is to bring in an outside independent source to review the issues and make whatever recommendations are appropriate. I also would like to see a successful settlement of the fire department negotiations. I've been very active in those, and I'm optimistic that within the next few months we will reach that agreement. A continuing emphasis needs to be placed on attracting new sales tax producing businesses to Oak Brook. We need that. Even though our sales tax have increased 9%, as was mentioned before, the past year, you never know what's going to happen in the future. We need to maintain tight control of our costs and continue to get whatever sales tax revenue we can. We have the best, Oak Brook is a great community. We have the best geographic location in the Chicago area. We have highly educated people. We have great businesses. There's no reason we can't be extremely successful in the future, but we have to be diligent to maintain what we have and improve it. In closing, I'd like to say there's been one overriding theme during all my years as an elected official. I take time to listen to whoever wants to talk to me. I know I don't know all the answers, and I appreciate your input on what the issues are and what the goals should be. I've been endorsed by the Oak Brook Caucus, the Doings, and the Daily Herald, and I hope you will consider voting for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. I've got some questions to ask of the trustees, and I'm wondering myself whether I should ask you individually or as a group, and then see what responses you would like to make. The first one is regarding electrical supply to the village. My understanding is it's on the ballot for this April's election. Do you have any of you have any particular ideas about this process? Let's start with Mike again.
The referendum, my position is I support it. Obviously, competition is good in helping our rates, but the residents of Oak Brook have to understand that that does not eliminate, even if we choose another carrier, it doesn't eliminate ComEd from the equation. ComEd will still be maintaining the lines, so I know there's been a lot of difficult situations with the maintenance of those lines. That will still be the responsibility of ComEd. Also, if the village does opt to go with another carrier to save money, the residents themselves, if I understand correctly, can opt out and remain where they're at. So my position is I support a yes vote in that.
Thank you. Any other to add to that? Jerry.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with ComEd and electrical rates. I look like an easygoing guy, but I can get angry. And I got angry 4 years ago when ComEd really jacked up our rates. And I became an activist and, along with other people, fought to get the rates reduced, which we did succeed in doing. I agree with Mike. You should vote yes on the referendum. What's happening is there's deregulation taking place, and there are a lot of companies. You probably received mailings already. There are a lot of companies offering you the right to buy electricity from them. Keep in mind that what they're offering is only the electric supply. ComEd still has the wires. So if you look at your electric bill, about half of it is probably for the supply. That's the part of the bill that will be affected, maybe 5%, maybe 10%, maybe more. You have a changing situation here. And the fact is, the speculation is that ComEd is going to be further reducing rates in the June timeframe. If you sign up with one of those people right now, you may be locked into a contract that you don't want. My advice is vote yes on a referendum. Consider not doing anything in the short term with one of these other companies. Let's wait and see how this unfolds. Let's wait and see what the village can negotiate with these third parties. And then later on this year, you'll have enough information to make a more intelligent decision. If you do elect to go with a third party, rest assured ComEd still will supply the electricity, and if a line is down, they will fix it.
Thank you, Jerry. Asif.
I'm not going to repeat what's been said, but I'm supporting it. I'd urge all of you to support it because there's no downside. I mean, you got ComEd now, you're going to get the same price structure if you opt out. It creates an alternative where you could possibly get some savings, and you don't have to take them if you don't want to. You can stick with the same program you're in now with ComEd. So. You got nothing to lose.
Okay. Tony?
Ditto.
Thank you for being brief.
I presented the issue to the board on behalf of several of the residents in my area. Everything that was said here is absolutely true, real simple. Can't lose. No lose situation. Vote yes.
Thank you. No shocks there, then?
No. Don't give up the day job.
Next question would be, let's pick this legal costs again. I'm sorry to return to this in some ways, but it's been quite a popular area of questioning. Anybody have any thoughts on the legal costs? Yes, Tony?
William Shakespeare, kill all the lawyers. Sorry, Fred. It is an issue. We look at the dollars and we say $752.5 million, dollar here, dollar there. It is an issue. It has been brought forth. It deserves the full study of the board to see if there is a better way to get legal representation. We live in very complicated times. Life is just not simple like it should be. We need legal representation. I'd like to fix that, but I can't. We need to make sure we're properly represented. If we can find a better, cheaper way to do it that'll protect you and us, we should do it. If we can't, and that's where we are.
Yes, Keith.
Well, I think it's when you kill all the lawyer except on my daughter.
Nothing personal, Doc.
No, that's okay. Henry VIII. Let's kill all the lawyer except on my daughter. You know, again, as I said, it's some evidence-based. I was curious why the legal costs were so expensive. I inquired, how do we pay to the lawyer? My understanding goes, I got here is all the numbers, Hinsdale, Warrenville, LaGrange, Oak Brook, Westmont, Western Spring, Lamont, Tinley Park, Woodridge, Glen Ellen. Turn out to be, the payer to the lawyer is we are low and lowest out of all these communities. And then the parent also, I did ask another thing. Every board meetings, the lawyers were sitting there. Is that traditionally required, or is this just happened to this during this time? My understanding was it has been. Traditionally, lawyers are sitting just in case needed, per hourly paid for the board meetings. $180 per hour. You know, for example, like some Hinsdale was paying is $5,000 per month and the additional or the legal cost, and the Warrenville paying $10,000 retaining fee per month, and then they give extra cost, and the LaGrange paying $290 per hour. And so Lamont was paying at least $150. All others is more or thin. The question begging is this is because they're paying too much to the lawyer, or are we so happy to sue each other? The lawyer's work doesn't happen. They cannot generate their own income. If us, you know, remember, the reason why we are losing income is the trade and any kind of product in industries compared to China, Japan, or Korea. They don't sue each other, or they cannot sue. Remember what you saw during this time, you know, the tsunami and the rhino, the nuclear going. Have you seen anybody jumping around, the screaming, yelling, kicking, said, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to sue you? No such things. So in certain sense, yes, I think we should try to reduce legal costs. But question is, we have to, again, what I said earlier, we need to grow up. Do we sue for anything, or do we complain anything legally? So any place, those town who are rich, they will end up to pay more legal costs. Remember, they go to the fat pig. They don't go to the, if there's no money, nobody will sue. You know, so deep pocket, we say. So my question, my answer to that is, yes, we have to be always reduced. I am absolutely, it's repugnant suing each other. We are the victim. You know medical malpractice, why the medical costs are expensive. I am the victim. Nonetheless, I'm asking, is, again, Shin, let's all grow up.
I think we have the message.
Thank you.
Thank you. Asif.
Well, you know, it's a factor of a couple of things. You do need lawyers here, and they serve a purpose, and there are certain functions that need to be done by them, and they are the experts. And Tony, I understand your position, but I think you have an ulterior motive because you drum up some business for yourself if you got rid of all the lawyers.
Why not pay me?
Okay.
But no, seriously, it's a factor of the hourly rate and the hours billed. And the hours billed are a function of familiarity with the issues. Some lawyers, you go to them, they're familiar with the stuff. They know the answer off the top of their heads. Others will give you a bill for 3, 4, 5 hours researching things. I don't have enough information to tell you anything other than the costs are a lot higher than they were a few years ago. And it needs to be looked into thoroughly, and we shouldn't jump to any conclusions. But we need to make sure we're getting a good value, or take whatever steps we can to ensure that we do get a good value.
Okay, thank you. Jerry, yes.
Yeah, I'd like to add 2 points. Number one, I think we should evaluate having a counsel that's on salary for some things. You get into a lot of special litigation, which they can't handle. But instead of paying strictly by hour, a lot of communities have a lawyer who's there, you know, for X dollars per week or X dollars per month, and I think we should reevaluate it at this point in time. The second thing is, as a trustee, we have to be very careful what actions we take, because if we take the wrong actions, that can result in suits. So my advice to whoever gets elected is be very careful what you do.
Thank you. Yes, Mike.
Very, very quickly, hourly rates can be misleading. If you look at our hourly rate, we have a low hourly rate. But if you look at our bill at the end of the year, which is what you should be looking at when you're looking at attorney fees, and there's been some conversation, and I have some numbers in front of me. For example, in 2008, the village spent $635,000 on attorney fees. Nearly $400,000 of that went to Odelson and Sterk. About $150,000 went to Seyfarth and Shaw, and then two other firms had less than 50. So a lion's share of the attorney fees are going to the counsel, Odelson and Sterk. But the question is, that money being spent on attorney fees can be better served in other ways, perhaps free garbage pickup for the residents again. There's other areas that money can be spent and do something better for the residents of Oak Brook.
Thank you. One near the last question, and I don't know how to phrase this. It just came from the floor this evening. Obviously, you candidates work better with some people than others, as we all do. We're all human. Is there any candidate for president that you would rather be working with? I'm posing the questions. If you don't want to answer it, fine.
Oh, you mean the trustees are asking?
The trustees, yes, yes. Yes, Jerry.
Well, first of all of us up here would be nuts if we answered it any other way than to say we'd be delighted to work with whoever gets elected. Right, and speaking for myself, I have worked with President Craig for the last 4 years, and I also worked with Gopal in the Plan Commission for several years. So I know I can work with them, and in fact, I've been an elected official for 12 years, and there's nobody I couldn't work with. But I guarantee you everyone here is going to say the same thing. I would hope everyone here is going to say the same thing.
Thank you, so would I.
I think it's only fair that you ask the two of them the same question.
We'll work with whoever trustees get elected.
Thank
Not
you.
A surprise.
So may I just ask one thing? I would like to request to the older citizens, I'm not so sure how much pleasure I will have be able to talk to all of you. Since Mr. DeCanio quoted Latin, let me quote Latin as well. As Sir Thomas More used to say, homo hominis lupus, the man is wolf to the man. That's what Sir Thomas More, who was beheaded by Charles VIII, and for religious reason, and he's the only one who is a saint, as well as there's the aristocrat of England. Whoever being elected, please, as a fact. I recently had a newspaper, and the other day, quoted about the incident of Grotto. And I thought there was also a follow-up comment that was very derogatory to the members who are not running for the trustees. And that the accused said that something was wrong. Turned out to be nothing else. Like the idea was that there's a policeman was patrolling to the grotto, the bar. And Mr. Craig was there, came out, asked, where is your sergeant? The answer was, sergeant is not here. And then he said, sergeant is supposed to be there in the checkups. And then the policeman said, the sergeant is a duty in office, but he told us to go. And this is a police report. And he said, what I'm asking very simple thing is, let's try not to divide. You said the pledge to the flag, let's not to divide. I hope whoever being elected, be gentlemen. Don't use any innuendos. Don't use any personal attacks. I'm begging. That is one of the lowest things. That's the reason why our reputation, it's not because anybody, it's we all are guilty if there is our reputation being tarnished. That's what I would like to ask, in case if I don't have any more opportunity, I'm just begging for the good of our children, good of our grandchildren, let's be civilized.
Key, can we continue? I think we've got what you're saying. Yes, Mike, you had one.
No, the comment I wanted to make is that I'm very happy with the tone of the campaign. I love these types of forums where we debate issues. We talk about attorney fees. We talk about economic development. We talk about issues that are important to Oak Brook. And I haven't seen any personal smears at any of these forums. When I look at the campaign literature, I see everybody's campaign literature very, very positive. There is a negative piece being handed outside. I wasn't given one, but none of the candidates that I have seen has put out anything negative. And I hope it remains that way, because 2 years ago, you may remember, the last weekend before the campaign, a vile and hateful 6-page, 7-page letter came out against candidates. And I hope that doesn't happen this time around. And when I announced that I was running for candidacy, I won't say who it was, but a resident of Oak Brook did attack me, saying I do not live in Oak Brook. I never lived in Oak Brook. I didn't even respond, because I'm going to stay on point. I'm going to talk about issues that are important to the residents, issues that are important to the future of Oak Brook. And having a young family, they're extremely important to me. But I commend for now all the candidates that are running, and you can look at our literature, all of it is extremely positive. But the biggest challenge we will have is uniting this divided town after April 5th.
Mr. Manjo, I don't mean it as we did that. I'm saying the tone of the town. Mm-hmm. As you're a politician, I'm sure you've been reading very well about all the newspapers you are endorsed as well. Mm-hmm. Look at the doings, the follow comment mm-hmm. about the mayor previously is Mr. Capetti's remark, whatever. You read all those in comment. Mm-hmm. How could you say you are not dirty? This is kind of personal attacks.
Mm-hmm. As, you are know, the candidate? Are the candidates?
No, not candidate. I'm not saying, that's the reason I'm asking. Mm-hmm. We need a candidate. We have to crawl. Every of their supporters.
And we're conducting ourselves very well.
Okay. Well, thank you for
on
doing that.
On a lighter
that.
Note, I'm going to say to my friend please. John Craig and to Dr. Lamalani, if it's this damn hot in here when we're having meetings, I get pretty crabby. So.
Well, say one thing. Yes, of course, John.
One thing that I've noticed, every candidate, and I admire them for this, told something about their family. I didn't. But I can tell you that I'm going on 52 years of marriage to the lady sitting in the first row. And we've had our ups and downs, but we're still hanging in there. We have two children. One graduated from the United States Naval Academy, is now a Navy captain. Next step is Rear Admiral. Our daughter is a lieutenant and she in the Navy and graduated from Hinsdale Central and Northwestern University. So I'm very proud of the little family I have. Thank you. And my wife.
I just want to make a,
Goebel, yeah.
If I could, make a follow-up comment.
Yes.
And Dr. Shin, as well as Manzo, made some beautiful comments. One of my first order of business, if I do get elected, is bringing back this fractured community that we have here. I think we are a very small family. We are not even 8,000 people. We should be able to live together peacefully. We should be able to be compassionate and caring to each other. We should be able to work together. We are going to have differences once in a while. And in any family, just like this family of Oak Brook, we will have small differences from time to time, but we should be able to overcome that. And we should not be disagreeable to each other. So that will be my first order of activity, is to bring this community back together so that we can live like a happy family again.
That will be good. We have a question here regarding what actions or what suggestions you might have for facilities in the village that do bring us together, one of which would be the library or the Heritage Center, or perhaps the Bath and Tennis. Does anyone have any remarks about
well,
this?
Well, my dream would be, you know, one of the things that we get criticized for in Oak Brook is we have no little town center like Hinsdale or Elmhurst. But I can envision, now there's people, some say, oh, yeah, that's a dream. But it is a dream that we could take the area along Salt Creek east of the tollway there and create a little village. We could have gondolas, we could have little shops, and it'd be a center where people could come and congregate and spend a day enjoying the outdoors. And I'm not saying you can have gondolas in the wintertime, but you certainly could have them in the summertime. And they used to have them years ago on the Des Plaines River in the Villa Venise. And those of you that are old enough would remember it was just lovely. And so we could still have a center.
Thank you, John. There were one or two hands I saw come up.
Go ahead.
Asif.
Well, with regard to the Bath and Tennis Club, we get about $80,000 in dues from the residents. Given my analysis of our current financial situation and some of the consulting fees that I feel we could cut back or eliminate, I think we're in a position where we could make that facility free for all the Oak Brook residents. The differential impact is $80,000 on a $20 million general fund. We all paid for it. It was the only time when in the history of Oak Brook when we had a real estate tax. We should all be able to enjoy it. It's a small amount of money, but it gives a great deal of value and enjoyment to everybody. Now, I can't make that happen without the support of either three trustees and the village president or the support of four trustees. So I'm not going to promise it, but I'll sure advocate it.
Thank you. Any other? Jerry.
Yeah, I think two things. One, let's look at what we have right now, and then the other is let's think about the future. In terms of what we have now, we do have some good facilities, some great facilities. I see Bobby Peltz from the library. Our library is a wonderful facility, and they have terrific programs. I was there last weekend for a program on turkey. They have the Evergreen Concerts where they serve wine and cheese and so on. And to me, the library is a wonderful asset, and I view it as a community center to some extent. We're going to hear about the Park District later. That's another great asset we have. I agree with, was it Asif or Mike, on the Bath and Tennis Club. So we have some things, and we just have to make sure we make the best use of them. Thinking longer term, in many ways, the Oak Brook Shopping Center is kind of the hub. The good news is that General Growth Corporation, which owns the shopping center, is coming out of its financial problems. They're putting $12 million into the shopping center in the short term, and I know they have plans longer term to make some significant changes. I think we should work with the shopping center to see if there are things they can do as they rebuild that would provide more of a central hub. That may or may not be possible, but we should pursue it.
Yeah, briefly, Keith.
I'm so glad this Park District is here too. We have the sports facilities. It's a golf club and the BNT and the Park District. I know Park District is independent. I would like to see if they have its regular Board of Trustee meetings, combined Board of Trustee meetings, and that they could put the resources together. And we should be able to then either advertise more efficiently, or we were able to provide more incentive to our village, I mean the people. So if we could use this the Oak Brook Village as well as Park District, I hope we can have something every regular Board of Trustee meetings, joint Board of Trustee meetings. That's what I hope.
Thank you. There's the two final questions I'm going to ask you. They were asked of the two presidential candidates. It's regarding video recordings. Would you, all of you, support having video recorded debates between candidates in 2 years' time? Is there anyone who would not like that? Okay. Silence. If you are running for re-election in 4 years, would you participate in such a debate between candidates?
I think it's absolutely. I think it's wonderful things.
Is that a yes?
Yes.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Good. Next, that would conclude, I think, the listening to the trustee candidates. I have one other question, and it's regarding school districts, which, of course, I can't present here because the trustees have nothing to do with school boards. It's a general question you probably are all interested in, which is how do you feel about unifying the 8 districts so that all Oak Brook children can be in one district?
May
of course,
I
it's not a not an issue in front of this board. However, it's of interest to people.
May I yes. answer something about that? I spent 38 years as a teacher in special education, and I can tell you that the school districts we have 5 school districts within the corporate limits of Oak Brook. 5 different school districts. Now, we have an enrollment in the Brook Forest and the Butler School District. It is going down and down, and we need more children. How could we do that?
Well, you have to encourage the process.
How could we do that?
Anyway, John,
start
I'd like to move on.
I know there's...
So, President, I could provide you with some prescriptions.
Well,
prescription for success.
Well, anyways,
what an outstanding fellow you are.
The way, you know, these school districts, I said, were formed when this was farmland. There wasn't anything here. And they said, okay, at the end of McCormick Street or McCormick's Farm, that becomes District 48, and this one's 53, and so forth. Now, Paul Butler said he had 2 things that he wished he had done. 2 things. And those things were have sidewalks in Oak Brook, and number 2, a unified school district. But I can tell you right now, you asked Downers Grove to give up the taxation that they receive from some of those houses in Oak Brook. They're not going to do it.
I understand that.
Just a quick comment on the school issue, if I may.
Yes.
As much as it's an interesting subject to discuss, I believe it's outside the purview
Correct.
Of the village
Correct. Absolutely.
Or the village
Yes.
president or the trustees.
Yes.
So
I only brought
it's
it
sort
up
of a meaningless discussion, even
correct.
Though I sympathize with the issues that are here.
I just brought it up because some people in the audience might not be aware that it's not a village issue.
Right.
Okay, now if we can thank these good gentlemen for presenting themselves, and we'll now move on. We'll now move on to the sole representative of the two candidates for Park District, and it's Tom Truthson. Now, Tom has gracefully agreed to come tonight, even though he's a person who is guaranteed to win. There are only two candidates and only two positions. So congratulations ahead of the vote.
Thank you. You're definitely getting elected.
Yes. Would you like to say anything, Tom?
I just wanted to take advantage of being able to sit down here with these gentlemen, because this is a great seat to watch this entire debate. It's been a lot of fun. As Simon said, my name is Tom Truthson, and really my purpose of coming here today was to just enlighten you on some of the things with regarding the Park District and who your elected officials are. We unfortunately don't really get much participation, very many people attending our board meetings, but actually that's probably a good thing. That must mean that you enjoy what we're doing or you appreciate what we're doing and don't really feel a need to come out. But just to give you some background, in light of the lateness of the hour, I'll keep my comments brief. I actually grew up in Oak Brook. I was born and raised here. I'm 55 years old, and I've lived here my entire life. My parents moved here the year I was born, and so I've been very blessed in, I think, having the opportunities that come from being in this town and attending Butler School and going to Hinsdale Central, and all the academics and athletic opportunities that were there, they certainly helped me in my life. I went to Oregon and competed there on an athletic scholarship, and then decided to move back here to Illinois. I currently live in Brook Forest and have lived there for 11 years. And I lived in with my family in Fullersburg Woods for 14 years and served on the Fullersburg Woods board there as treasurer. I've got my lovely wife, Patty, who also grew up in Oak Brook, grew up in the Robin Hood Ranch. And we have four wonderful children. Patty actually works at Butler School as a teacher's aide. We've worked with Connie quite a bit over there. And we just love Oak Brook. We made a choice to move back here because both having grown up here, we came back here for the education and what our children could have. And all of our children have gone through Butler School and have gone through Hinsdale Central. I have a senior right now at Hinsdale, our youngest. Otherwise, my oldest graduated from U of I this past year. And I have two other children, one at Indiana and one at Iowa. And as I said, we're very blessed in what we have. I'm a partner in a direct marketing company. I started the company 21 years ago. It's called The Core. And what we do at our company is work with very large corporations, like some of our clients, Wells Fargo, Allstate, in marketing and helping them find their customers and understand what it is that they need to help them grow their business. And that's, I think, a very fine attribute that I bring to the Park District. And part of what my aspirations have always been is to help and identify what you as the residents of Oak Brook want and desire to see programming from the Park District. And I think we've done a good job in bringing that to, I think, the community. We've certainly had our challenges along the way in some of our staffing and I think growing the Park District. But today we're sitting, I think, in a very strong, balanced budget position. We've built out, I think, to all the different levels that we possibly can as far as the type of assets that we're going to be adding. And so today it's actually looking at what is it that we can do to help provide programming that meets your needs. And we've got an older population, largest in DuPage County, over 55. So we have the Pioneer Program. And we have other things as well, including the Aquatic Center, the Racquet Club, and all kinds of different facilities for you to use. And so I encourage you to come on out to the Park District. We've got a track there that you can walk on, and I can tell you my dad walks there every single day. And there's something to be said for physical fitness, because he was 101 in February.
Hey. So.
Thank you, Tom.
That's my message.
I have a couple of questions that were sent to us by email, and it's regarding the term length of Oak Brook Park commissioners. My understanding is you each serve 6 years, and this is your third term, which will mean you will have, because we know you're going to be elected,
yes,
will have served for 18 years. And your colleague, John O'Brien, it's his fourth term, which means he will have served for 24 years. Does this long 6-year term discourage people from wanting to participate in the board membership?
Probably.
If that's the case, your vote was not to shorten it.
It's actually a question that's come up a number of times. And one of the participants out in the audience there, Harry Peters, we've had many discussions. And there's been thought that perhaps Harry was a former commissioner with the Park District. That's why I point Harry out. We've talked about it at great length, because there are some current commissioners that say that they would have preferred it being 4 years, yet they ran and they're serving their 6-year term. Personally, I actually prefer a 6-year term. There's less running that has to go with it. It's what most of the other park districts have across the state, so we're not odd by having a 6-year term. We've got 5 board members. That's pretty consistent with what's out there. We've been approached, should we have more board members? And personally, I think you weigh that and say we always get enough candidates to serve. I think we've had very good candidates. Obviously, we don't have a plethora of them because I am running unopposed, but actually I think that's a benefit. So I don't really have an answer for you. It's been discussed. We continually come back to, and it's left where it is at 6 years and a 5-member board.
Other two questions from the same questioner was regarding taxes that the Park District imposes and the use of money and the what is seen as the neglect of satellite parks, because the wonderful facilities in the central location, but the Park District is responsible for other areas as well.
That's a very good question. We are a taxing body that was put in place when the Park District originally was started. But you do need to know that we are the lowest in the western suburbs. We're half, in some instances even less than what other park districts get from the residents. We take that very seriously. It's part of why I'm here today. I wanted you to hear who we are, who I am, and what we're about as far as a park district. I think fiscal responsibility is the most important thing that I can bring. When I ran, it was on the premise of running it as a business. And businesses have to be accountable. Whether you have shareholders or it's just your own pocketbook, you're looking to not spend money. And if something's not working, change it. Get rid of it. And if your staff isn't doing what it needs to be doing, then get people in that do. Oak Brook is a special community. You have an opportunity to go other places. We are a business, for lack of a better term, and we need to meet your needs. And I encourage, if you ever have any questions or have anything that you'd like to see different or aren't happy with, then please come to a meeting, call us, send us an email. We read, we look at all those communications. As far as satellite parks and back to that, the person that contacted you is right. We've actually taken steps this past year. We're upgrading and going to be improving Saddlebrook and Forest Glen and the tennis courts out there. Those facilities have gotten to be abysmal. But part of it is it's not cheap. It's going to cost upwards of about $80,000, and it's not something, again, we took lightly. We tried to get a measurement of how much usage there is. One of my main questions was, and we talked to the Saddlebrook folks about is how much usage are you going to get? I had a conversation with Harry Peters specifically. How many people use your tennis facility? All I wanted to do was make sure that we didn't spend $80,000 and nobody used it. Because I don't live there. I live in Brook Forest. The tennis facilities in Brook Forest are owned by Brook Forest, so we pay for those as a community ourselves. So, again, I question every single thing. We look at the warrant every month, which is basically where we're spending money. I review that. I try not to get petty, but occasionally we ask questions that are not of big dollars. But you know, if you're not watching the little dollars and you're not letting the staff know about that, things can get away from you. And again, we try and add and take advantage of things like grants. We got a grant for the Dean Nature Sanctuary. If you haven't been over there, that has basically been a transformation to where it's a prairie that utilizes, as I said, half of it was paid for by a grant. So again, take it very seriously, the taxation and so forth.
Well, Tom, I thank you for coming, since you are unopposed, and for telling us something about what you do. Thank you. Now, another unopposed candidate is Charlotte Proust, the village clerk, and she would like a few minutes. 1 minute. Okay, 1 minute starts when you arrive on the floor.
Hey, okay, that works. Okay, I wanted to tell you, I voted already. I went for early voting. It's a piece of cake. I can tell you, I went over to the strip mall.
Mike.
Oh, I'm sorry. I brought it down, didn't use it. Anyways, I went over there this week, and we parked in the first parking space right in front of the strip mall on the north side of Yorktown. We walked in. I showed him my driver's license. I filled out the form. I voted, and I was out. If it took 5 minutes, it was a long time. And, you know, it's wonderful. I went with weather like this. In fact, while I was there, there were four other Oak Brook residents, which made me feel good. I'd like to feel like I sent everybody there. But it's the second store. It's right next to the corner Baidu restaurant. They have a flag in front. They have a sign in front. They have signs in the windows. There's nothing on the roadways, however. They're open Monday through Friday, 10 to 7. They're open Saturday, 10 to 3. And they're open Sunday, 11 to 3. And this only goes on to the 31st of March. The other place that's close to us is the municipal building downtown Elmhurst. Their hours are different. They're only open Monday through Friday, 9 to 4:30. Most important that you vote. The other thing that I want to bring up is I have all the current polling places on the front page of our website. The one for Oprah Club and Timber Trails is now at the Dufry Building, which is 814 Commerce Drive. The precincts are York 124, York 125. I haven't been over there, so I can't give you as many details, but what is stated to me, there's ample parking. It's on the first floor. So I'll go over there and look, and the next board meeting I'll make some more announcements. But if you have any question, I do have applications for absentee ballots. If you're going to register to vote, you got to go to the county. I can't do anything for you here. Any questions? I'm happy to help you. Is that a minute?
Thank you, Charlotte.
Everybody vote for me.
We know how much you need it.
Well, we all at the Civic Association encourage you to vote. If you don't vote, you can't complain. If you do vote, great. I'm sure everyone will appreciate your input and interest in the village of Oak Brook. At the same, additionally, I'd like to ask for more support for our little association. And you can support us by paying fees, annual fees, which help pay for the newsletter every month. Or if you have a business, as Stan earlier mentioned, you could place an advertisement in the newsletter every month or in the annual calendar. Now, in the newsletter, it's much appreciated if you advertise every month. It can just be a small portion of a page, a sixth of a page. But I feel, as someone like Tom, who's involved in advertising and marketing, that a repetitive advertisement stays in a person's mind more than one page once a year. So I would encourage anyone who has a business to advertise in our newsletter. It's a very modest fee. So thank you for coming. Appreciate it. Don't forget to vote. And there are some refreshments at the back, some cookies and some liquid of some kind.
Thank you.
Thank you once again.
Thanks, Simon.